target is nearby.
Russians nearby.
Tango sighted.
I'm with you.
Gotcha.
Burning off! Tangos are trying to flank us!
That's your target. neutralized. Good work. Target spotted, Sheriff.
My target.
Serious trauma detected.
Cover you. On the target.
Target down. Good job. Looks like you earned yourself another bounty. Well done.
standpoint is to start catapulting guys and making them visible and making their brand stronger, and also just showing skills-wise, look, this could be a serious threat to John Jones. If Anthony Smith goes in there and destroys Alexander Gustafsson, we're going to go, okay, that Rashad Evans wins, that Sheldon Rua wins, like, he is legit. It wasn't any fluke. He's a legit contender. But there's no road back to John Jones, at least for now. Say you would have put in Johnny Walker in there, you could have the same result. All of a sudden, we want to see Johnny Walker versus John Jones. And you can plug in Luke Rockhold against Anthony Smith. They had a nice little back and forth, and people were, you know, wanted to see that matchup. And for some reason, it didn't get booked. Imagine if he beats Anthony Smith. You know, the guy who went five rounds with John Jones that not many people are able to do. All of a sudden, you know, you want to see Luke Rockhold versus John Jones. You know, a lot more. I feel like people already want to see it.
Yeah, real adjustments
in boot. Just fuel the fire a lot more. And this fight has no... There's no end in as far as, like... there's no clear picture as far as, like, whoever wins here, we don't know what's next.
Okay, here's what I'm just not buying.
But no, I agree with you that it does... At the end of the day, it does answer some questions. We are going to find out where Anthony Smith, if he's a legit... You know, top five light heavyweight. We found out he's not the guy. That guy's John Jones.
Yes.
But with this matchup, we're gonna find out if he's a top five or not.
Now, honestly, I'm not saying it's the perfect fight. God, I'm not saying it's this was the one that had to get made. That's not what I'm saying.
In danger.
But I guess I'm still not buying some. What y'all are selling me here a little bit. We're haggling here at the Turkish market. I guess the thing is this. Number one, we're like, oh, a path back to a title. Guys, they both just lost in title fights.
Yes.
It wouldn't matter who they fought next. That's a long way off.
Okay.
So, secondly, hold on. This is the second point because it's relevant to this. It can't be both. It can't be both that you are admittedly telling me this is a super thin division without
Agent
names.
Jamie,
and also,
backup.
What's the road back? The answer is you don't need much of a road. What's the road back to a Bellator title? Being present, getting a win or two, and just having your name out there? It's a very similar situation. So I'm not saying that, look, it's the winner here, catapults, rockets, oh, I mean, they're going to get... No, I agree with that. It's a little bit of like a bit of a murky situation. But we don't know when Johnny Walker's coming back, and maybe Dom Reyes doesn't get it done. One more win from these other two guys, especially in the case of Smith, who has not lost twice. Not buying it, fellas.
Right, well,
not buying it.
And I get what you're saying. You can't be half pregnant. But ultimately, do you lose here if you're UFC and Anthony Gustafsson takes two losses in a row?
Anthony Smith.
I'm sorry, Alexander Gustafsson would take two losses in a row when he is your second biggest name in this division. Yeah, you're not going to put him in a trilogy anytime soon against John Jones. But again, from the idea of testing those other names, he's your A side if you want to test him against these other names. Why are you testing him against Anthony Smith? Well, I mentioned how many losses he has. He's still got to prove that he is an elite fighter, in my opinion. Going back in there against Gustafsson just doesn't seem to make a ton of sense unless they're rewarding him there. Or, I don't know, not taking a DQ win over John Jones. Is that it?
I mean, let's just drop down to the 145 pound division for a second. Look how they were matchmaking Jose Aldo. I wasn't in favor of Jose Aldo fighting 145. I wanted to see that 155. But nonetheless, he was put in matchups where, look, it's a you know, a coin flip in the sense of it could go either way. Yes, but at least if a certain outcome happens, you can catapult somebody into, you know, maybe not stardom.
So after the second Holloway fight.
Yeah. For example, he fought Jeremy Stephens, right. And we thought, you know, Jose Aldo might probably win, but if Jeremy Stephens wins, only, you know, he's up there, and all of a sudden you might want to see Holloway versus Stephens. This is not the same case. Whoever wins here, there's no path back to John Jones, at least for the moment being. And, you know, as Brian noted, these are big names. You know, Gustafsson is flirting with retirement. I mean, he's not sure where he's at right now in his career. So we don't know if he has a couple fights left in him, one fight left in him, a bunch. We don't know. But at least use the star power that he has, because he does have some star power, and try to build somebody else. Somebody else that hasn't gotten a crack at the title. I feel like that's what Brian is getting at.
Johnny Walker would have been a great choice in this particular case.
How about Luke Rockhold versus Alexander Gustafsson?
I guess he just wasn't ready. I agree. The Luke Rockhold one is so interesting for that division, you know, and especially if also, we'll talk about him later in the show, if you will, Romero moved up to 205. I think he'd get a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have been any different if this main event.
That's your target.
And Volkan Ozdemir. To me, you got storylines there. Ozdemir coming on. I know he's in the co-main event.
You would have preferred
the TV.
That?
Well, from how else is storyline? Ozdemir's on a 3-fight losing streak. I know he kind of got screwed in that last fight. If he goes to a 4-fight losing streak, you're basically like, look, that's a fall from grace. He's not that guy. And it also kind of gives Gustafsson in his hometown, in a main event that's going to be decently profiled, to kind of bounce back against a guy on a 3-fight losing streak. It's not going to hurt the UFC that much if Volkan takes
it. I don't think it's a bad fight either. This is when people are like, when news. I've talked to you about this before on the MMA Hour. Like, when news breaks about a fight, people, like, get super excited. To me, I don't think every fight is equivalent. That would be a silly thing to say. But kind of, there are certain situations where one fight is not necessarily all that much more cool than the other one. I take some of your point. I don't think it's possible to fight at all. I think it's a little bit too cynical and a little bit too unfair. The guys are coming off the title fight more. They have a room back in line, and there's still plenty of uncertainty. Could there have been more tomorrow? Probably. But you do get some here.
And I think that a couple days after the loss to Jones about taking the fight against his own wishes, I think that fueled some of this argument. At the end of the day, it's going to be a fun fight. I want to see it. Let's see what happens.
It's going to be a good fight, you know, so that's all I meant. All
right, so I know folks love it online when I look at my phone. Here are some of the other fights on this card. Very quickly, I want to see what you guys thought of them. So the main event, of course, is Benavidez and Gustafson. Your co-main event, I kind of like this one. Speaking of Volkan Uzdemir, taking on Ilir Latifi. Brian, lover of the...
It's going to be action. And you got Volkan, who's going to be a little bit desperate there. And look, BC Latifi bags in the backyard.
BC Latifi, what you call him?
Yeah, it's going to be a fun one.
Cleaning
you
up
got
the streets one
really
bad guy at a time.
Striker versus somebody
nicely done, Sheriff.
And it's just a, you know, bulldoze move.
And fast versus kind of slow, but also explosive. Yeah. And also both guys coming off of losses. Kind of interesting there as well. Jimmy Manoa taking on Alexander Rakic. If you guys do not know, Alexander Rakic.
That's gonna be a banger.
I have a feeling you're about to find out. I've been watching this guy for a while. He was a little bit unrefined when I first saw him, kind of sticking to some more fight control tactics, a lot of takedowns on the sort of top control. He is a physical specimen.
3-0
in
the UFC
class.
From Austria. Looks like
tough,
could be somebody.
Trains at ATT.
KO power.
I'm telling you.
And that's why it's good matchmaking, because Jimmy Manuel is open and he's saying, look, I take losses if it means I can put out fun fights.
And also, he's pushing 42, so like, this is a much better, like, rising guy, maybe a guy who's a little bit on the back end of his career. Bakwan Amir Khani taking on Chris Fishgold. I can never get over him. They keep putting Chris Fishgold on all these, like, UFC Mars, UFC Saturn's Moons, or whatever. Demir Hadzevich taking on Christos Giagos, and the Daniel Teamer taking on Adonk. I can't name. Lastly, a couple other ones I wanted to sort of note here. Nick Hine versus Frank Camacho.
That's gonna
on
be
the
a
prelim.
Good one. Yeah.
Brain cells will be destroyed in that one. Stevie Ray taking on Leonardo Santos. Dude, Leonardo Santos.
Yep.
Folks forget, he beat Kevin Lee striking fast years ago.
Yep.
That's kind of just been on the shelf. Also, it's the Jiu-Jitsu World Championships this week, and he is a legit black belt. And then lastly, Tanya Evinger taking on Lena Landsberg. Did I miss anything of note?
I like the story behind Judah Santana, the 3-0 women's featherweight, who's going to be taking on Bad News Barbie there, who's 2-0. I forgot her last name. Judah's got an interesting backstory. I read a nice little junkie profile on her. Battled some substance abuse issues in her teenage years. Started her career, but then had to shelf it because of pregnancy. Was supposed to debut on the Brazilian Dana White series and couldn't get a visa. She's hungry.
All right, very good.
Hi, I'm Avery Truffleman, and I'm hosting Curb's new podcast, Nice Try. It's stories about how people have tried to design a better world and what happens when those designs don't go according to plan. Season one is called Utopian, and it's about the perpetual search for the perfect place.
Friendly combatants detected.
It includes cannibalism, fascist architecture,
supply
polyamory, hermetically sealed domes,
target
and Kourtney Kardashian's dining room chairs. But, you know, not
civilians
necessarily
in distress.
New episodes of Nice Try come out every Thursday. Subscribe for free on Apple Podcasts or in your favorite podcast app.
Hi, this is Peter Kafka. I am the host of Recode Media. It's an awesome podcast that I make about media.
Oh, no.
I want to tell you about a specific episode I think you'll like listening to. It's with Jimmy Pitaro, president of ESPN, one of the most powerful programming networks on TV, also one that's under a lot of stress. He's been on the job about 15 months. We talked about what he's doing to sort of reshape that thing and or keep it competitive with all the other sports networks and the internet in general. It's a good conversation. You can listen to it for free. Jimmy Pitaro is on the Recode Media Podcast with me, Peter Kafka, on Apple Podcasts, or wherever you are listening to this message right now.
All right, let's take it to the next story. Then we had, I spoke to your favorite a couple of weeks ago, and then it came out just a short time after.
There
he
was
on the retirement. He's going to return to action. UFC Sacramento, I believe, in July 13th on ESPN Plus, which means virtually no one is going to pay attention. And he will be I think it's a co-main event role, certainly a main part of the plot.
Yes.
He's going to be back in the advanced weight division. He's been gone for about 3 years, 2.5, something along those lines. He's Sacramento. It wasn't like a terrible losing streak, but he made some other comments where I got over there. Here's my view on that. Do I really, am I moved by a Uriah Faber versus a Rose Bowl? No. And I know some folks were upset about it. Like, should have been BJ Penn. I don't know why people want BJ Penn to get a title.
That's the target agent.
Thirst is for this. I like it for Uriah because Ricky Simone has a very active workman-like style, but not necessarily, I don't want to say, not much of a threat to stop a fight, at least against a veteran like that, still pretty skilled. But it didn't really move me. I don't really feel anything about it. I'm not mad at the guy. I do think he's taking care of his health.
Yeah.
I think it's fine, but like, am I super psyched that he's back in this particular fight? No, not really. Where are you on this?
I don't mean to start off the show with the back-to-back arguments where I'm sort of pinpoint critiquing UFC matchmaking as if I'm some closet booker when it really matters, it doesn't. But you know,
also, it's a weird conversation to have. Like, the fight is what the fight is.
Yeah, but my stance ultimately, whether you're talking about Anderson Silva or any of the aging names, is if you're going to allow them to keep fighting and they're still credible, use their names for good. Now, you can argue they are. You can argue they've got Ricky Simone and say, look, on a nice little run here, maybe Uriah Faber can give him that rub. I sort of, from my standpoint, love the idea of putting aging legends in with other aging legends. BJ Penn is maybe the wrong argument, but the spirit of the BJ Penn conversation is not wrong. Because in this case, Simone loses. You just stunted his growth for what? Faber, you're not considering a title contender unless you're going to match something creatively, like if a Dom Cruz or a Dillashaw ran into a bell, and you're trying to sort of build a storyline off of history or something. If not, he's just fighting because he still can, because he still wants to. I don't love the idea when you're doing Anderson Silva against a Derek Brunson, against a Jared Cannonier, where you're like, storyline-wise, this is going nowhere. Seems like a waste of his name. I get you're putting Faber in Sacramento. That should sell tickets. You're making that the co-main event, using a main event that you made your enemy, right? Which doesn't seem like a main event at all, even with Aspen Ladd being from that area.
Target matchup,
terrible main event. I don't get that promotion selling tickets-wise.
Looks like you earned yourself another bounty. Well done.
Against another aging name, a Cub Swanson, go up and down the road, whoever you want. You can get the five-round argument. Again, not every main event has to be five.
What do you think, Danny?
I understand where you're coming from, but I also think there's a space for young guys to fight legends. Anderson Silva, Israel Adesanya, I thought that was, perfect matchmaking. And look what it did to Israel Adesanya. It just boosted his profile by a lot. So I like Ricky Simone's. I feel like, in some sort of way, he actually kind of looks like he would be part of Team Alpha Male. Like, he has that style.
That's true.
But yeah, I like that fight. I think he's super legit. He's got an awesome mullet as well.
Yeah,
so,
he has the best mullet I've ever seen.
For sure.
That's Mike Pyle.
Yeah.
He's got a better mullet than Mike Pyle.
Yeah, it's so long. But anyways, I think this is a fine fight, and I don't have, any problems with him coming back. I'm excited
really?
To see California Kid fight in Sacramento and see what he looks like. Because look, Uriah Faber, when we talk about the smartest fighters of all time, we always talk about GSP, but I feel like Uriah Faber is often left out. The guy left as a top five bantamweight. He left, on a win, in his hometown. He has one of the most recognized teams in MMA, author, successful businessman, etc. Takes pretty good care of his health, He's never been knocked out or anything like that. I think if anything, this break might have actually extended his career. It might have been actually a good thing. And he actually left when he was supposed to. I'm excited to see what he looks like. Yeah, decision and TKO.
But he had the thumbs up. Remember, Herb didn't see it.
He was fishing. He was trying to get a takedown. I believe a single, if I remember correctly. So I'm actually curious to see what he looks like at 135.
The curiosity factor is fine. The whole question is this the right matchup? And again, in the end, doesn't really matter. No.
If Ricky Simone's wins, like Uriah Faber in your resume, that's pretty darn good, man.
That's great. It's great for Ricky Simone. I'm happy for them. But like, I don't know. It doesn't move me. I don't feel anything. Like when they announced Max Holloway versus Frankie Edgar, which I realize is a very different scenario for a lot of different reasons. I'm just simply saying
that's a world title.
100%. It's not the same as apples or oranges in many, many capacities. And there was a debate about should have been Volkanovski versus Edgar. But at the end of the day, I was like, oh, God, I cannot wait to see that fight. There's no there with this one. Like, I'm not mad at Uriah Faber for coming back for all the reasons you mentioned. Good ambassador for the sport, taking care of his health. Not at some kind of tremendous knockout risk in this fight.
Has been active.
Fine, no problem. Go do what you want to do. The UFC wants it back, by the way. They tried to get Cody Garbrandt on this card. They couldn't, so they pulled it deep into the bag of tricks. Credit to the UFC for fine. All that stuff's fine. But, like, as a fan speaking, is this a fight I care about? No, it is not. It is not a fight I even remotely care about. And while the matchmaking, I gather, could have been different, we can always have these questions. I'm more trying to get a sense of like how the fan base feels about it. Also, he's pushing 40.
Yeah.
And you're right, he is a smart fighter, smart businessman, smart guy. At the same time, the knock on him when he retired was,
we're in the clear.
And I believe largely,
wow, that's awesome.
No fighter's perfect. Is that he didn't really adapt over time.
To,
he was sort of rejecting what the best practices that Dwayne Ludwig had brought to Team Alpha Male. You know, he beat Dominic Cruz the first time, they lost, and they rematched what UFC 199, I think somewhere around there, 198.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even close. Like, it was just, he got lapped. And so, I don't see how time off fixes that. I don't know that Ricky Simone's got to take advantage of it. I guess we'll see. But I don't know. For me, it just feels I'm a little
I'm more interested in UFC Sacramento now that your UFA was on that card than before.
I would say that's fine. If everyone's mileage will vary, I would say for me quite modestly.
And also, he's been off and he's been working a lot on his jiu-jitsu. We don't
target
know if
is
he's
nearby.
In that
watch his match with Nicky Ryan.
I didn't. But Nicky Ryan
it's
is Nicky
detected.
Ryan.
Okay, but it wasn't close. Like, it wasn't close for 30 seconds. You know, I'm not sure what to say.
You ever wonder if history would have been different with Faber got on the Gregor Mendoza?
Supply drive claimed.
It was funny on the Dan Hardy podcast. He said that Connor was talking about CJ. That catches my interest. That I would be like, okay.
What if your IFA pulls off a Shogun Rua and just extends his career by fighting once a year? Because I do feel like once you're older, your activity level should be a lot lower if you want to keep on fighting.
Friendly combatants.
I mean, 2 years can go by pretty quick, and it's not just 2 years for TJ Dillashaw, because like, it's 2 years until he can fight. He can start training camp before that. I don't know. Not far-fetched.
I would say this.
He gets two fights in, maybe.
That's what I'm saying. Not saying he can't be competitive, but I have reasons for skepticism. I don't think the Ricky Simone fight tells us a lot unless he wins, like, dramatically.
Detecting additional hostile contacts.
He's 26, young guy.
Incoming hostiles detected.
What's Ricky Simone's best win?
Who would you rather have favorite fight than?
Supplies nearby.
An old guy with a name.
Rather than BJ Penn here, Campbell's suggestion.
Penn idea. I can't believe people like BJ Penn is my friend. I'm like, what
is
wrong with
it all? Be a Frankie Edgar type. I know they
detecting
like brought
additional hostile
contacts.
Target is near you, agent.
I kind of like that one a lot.
Go to WEC,
throw it back. Empty. Saber coming up a little bit.
Supplies dropped
loss,
successfully.
You know, how much does it mean exactly? I don't know. But just, I don't know.
Nobody get Miguel Torres up the bullpen.
Yeah. Oh, God. All right, so let's do this one. Let's go to the
detected
next story.
Nearby location.
Kind of
guarded by hostiles.
Yoel Romero has...
Yoel Romero.
Did you see that online? You just come up with that.
Nice item.
Oh, that is such a good one. Yoel Dinero Romero is... well, what do I say? So, however long ago, I can't remember the dates at this point anymore, but he was flagged by USADA for a potential violation.
2015
is what it was? Yeah. And so it turns out that in the end, Romero drives the critics crazy.
Shit.
Because they think it's the end, they walk into the end of someone who just destroys all their arguments about advantages and which ones we tolerate. The guy has been tested at a higher level, whatever that's worth, longer than any other UFC athlete.
Like he was like 15.
Yeah, he's, by the way, his physique has not changed at all. And, like, there's been no swings in it whatsoever. And the one time he has an issue, he gets exonerated, essentially, by USADA. They still give him the 6 months more strict, the liability violation. But they basically says he did not cheat. That has to eat his critics alive.
I mean, for them it doesn't matter, because they just saw the headline, you know, Yoel Romero potential, you know, violation.
And the best part is,
they're
like, how could a 42-year-old man move like that? Guys, it's called unbelievable genetics. You see them with the guys out of Cuba all the time. You tolerate that.
You don't even need to go to Cuba. Just go to Miami.
Yeah, Miami. You guys think it's only possible with PEDs. This is the incoherency I've been trying to explain to you guys about what advantages you tolerate and don't. Different conversation for a different time. Here's what did happen, Brian. He got popped for this. And while he was exonerated at the end by USADA, he sued the company, I think called Gold Star Labs or whatever. Fly by night operation.
Like a special men's club.
It really does. Did you go to their website?
No, I
actually went to their website and looked at their products. It's standard stuff. BCAAs, crazy in my eyes, right? CLA, that kind of thing. A little bit of crack sprinkled on top. And he sued them. Anyway. Now, here's the deal. He wins $27.5 million, although there might be multiples of that, depending on who you listen to. You knew he sued a real above-board company because they didn't even respond to the lawsuit or show up, so he won, essentially, in absentia. And, again, I don't think he's going to get any of this money because I don't think Gold Star, on their best day, had $1 million, much less $27 million. He might drive them into bankruptcy.
So what is
we're going to assuredly will. What is the upside for you, Will? What does this event actually do for him?
Clear his name.
Does it clear his name?
Clears his name.
I'm not sure that it does.
Like, you're always going to have skeptics. You're always going to have skeptics in 2019 that everybody's using. And you got a body that's a wonderland like that. Good Lord. I mean, at that age, I mean, come on. I'm not talking to my hands, but, like, that's just absurd. But I think this is somebody who went to bat for himself and won. So it does clear his name. He's able to stand strong with that. You just don't see that today, because if you get even a sniff of that, you
don't target
for drugs recreational. Nice. It just sticks with you. Warren Sapp always said that. Remember the day before the NFL draft?
Cleaning up the streets one bad guy at a time. Nice and done, Sheriff.
What I'm saying is, I remember at the time, he was like, this is going to follow me my entire career. You guys will not stop harping on it. It's the first thing I thought about every time I heard Sapp's name throughout his whole career. To be able to turn back and erase that is strong, especially for a guy who still has it at this age, is still a contender, is still a factor, and wants to remove that in such a muddled climate of which side you're on in the drug test battle. I'm sure Professor Luke over here has got a long spiel you're going to become
about
how this exposes the drug testing system or how we should all juice along with them. I'm not really sure.
I advocate neither of these positions, but go ahead.
Yeah, but it seems like a victory.
Is it a real victory, or are we just saying it's a victory?
Nah, it is. I think the trolls will always be there no matter what. I think even if he never tested positive for anything, the trolls are always going to be there. And even with this, but nonetheless, it's another layer of, like, look, F you, I was clean. You know what I'm saying? Because if the court wouldn't have decided for Yoel Romero if it wasn't true. So this is, again, another victory for Yoel Romero. And I think on, talk to ESPN, he said it himself, like, I'm sick of the, soldier of steroids comments and all this stuff. Like, this in a way, like, it's more important than just the money. Like, look, guys, I'm clean.
Yeah, it wasn't about the money, and I respect that.
You gotta respect
that. I'm a little bit skeptical it will radically...
Not radically, but it's gotta do something. At least, look, if you're an intelligent human being, you see that and you go, oh, right, yes,
he was clean.
Yeah,
but most people are not.
Okay, well, whose opinion do you value?
Almost no one.
All right. Next.
No, I guess I'm just trying to think this through. Like, I'm just trying to wrestle with the idea. Like, if you get popped and then USADA comes back and says, okay, you didn't cheat. Could have been a little more careful.
Yeah.
But you didn't cheat. And then you sue a company and then you win a judgment.
You have received an invite to another agent's group.
In the end, I guess what I'm really trying to ascertain is, what does that do for the fighter or the athlete who did that? What is the real measurable benefit? Because we can probably all agree the money is not going to be there in most cases, unless it's some kind of.
It's a moral victory, is where you're going.
It's a moral victory. But I guess what I'm trying to say is.
And it cleans his name a bit.
Does it meaningfully change? Of critics, and I'm not talking about trolls, critics. Does this move the needle on critics, and should Danny other fighters do it? We know, for example, Lyman Good is trying. He hasn't. I think it's still unresolved. Is this a model that other athletes should follow?
For sure, because it does clear your name, up to some degree, right? Maybe not completely, but trolls are going to troll, right? But it does clear your name, and second, look, you might get some money out of it, so. And you did get screwed over by, ruining your reputation.
Why didn't
off
you
the
cage. Your order's on the roof, like, and you've got a lot of hostiles ahead.
Why didn't you shut up?
But it looks like the smoke's worth it. The auto cannon seems to be firing blind.
Maintain itself, but you could have been more careful.
Hostile control nearby.
Yeah.
How does this change? Like, why isn't what they said enough?
Oh, well, this is just, it should be enough. Because, you have USADA who's overseeing all of this, and they're the governing body of this. It should be enough, but... people have lost some trust with USADA depending, on certain situations. Once one thing's put into question, a lot of things are put into question. But this is just another layer of taking that even farther.
I think what he's saying is there's a cynical
guess I'm just a little bit... I feel happy for you, Will, because I saw the smile on his face with his agent. They were, like, arm in arm. It clearly mattered to him.
Yeah.
And I guess in the end...
Well, it calls everything he's accomplished in question, and there are certain pride in an athlete. Sometimes you just give up that pride. You're like, I can't please anybody. I don't care.
Right.
But I think for him, that pride was very, very important.
It's also just kind of a wake-up call as well. Like, I don't know what kind of money Will makes, but he typically makes a little bit better. He's been in some headlining slots.
Championship bout.
You know, like, you need some money to clear your name a little bit, which is a bit of an unfortunate situation.
It's a wake-up call for these providers of supplements who just sort of add things in and don't put them on the label.
No, this will keep happening. Here's what I would say. Unless there's my hunch, because this is not the first time it's happened. This happened in NFL.
Yeah.
It's happened in Major League Baseball. My hunch is that unless athletes really started to hammer them, like there was like a turnkey way where like Danny pops, but gets cleared, and then there, you know how there's like ambulance chasers? If there was like an ambulance chaser for athletes when it came to contaminated supplements, where they could pick up your case, file it, you know, and then just push it through, if there was a way to do that, and there was this avalanche
right.
of response.
And it became more of a reoccurring thing, common thing.
Yeah, like very frequent. Like you
yeah.
knew if they popped, we're going to get sued. Might get something, but until then, a lot of these athletes are like, I don't have the money, what's the point, I don't really
right.
care, like, I'm back fighting, you know, who else popped, the Dirty Bird, Tim Means,
yeah.
Is he suing the company that did it to him?
Well, not everybody can afford to go down
yeah.
that road.
That's my point, like, there's a financial barrier to name clearing that just seems a little bit unfortunate.
I'd do a cycle of TRT in a second to be able to grow an actually manly beard.
Yeah, you're stuck. Your beard is,
yeah.
It is trash, unfortunately.
I do like Danny's We Will Rock You mustache, though. Okay, I gotta put that
The bigote up. Is... legitimate.
Very prime mercury. I love it.
Thicker than yours?
Well, that's why I'm willing to go under. That's why I'm willing to get the injection right in the cheekbone.
All right.
We gotta do?
Let's go to the next story if we can. Max Holloway did some media tours in Canada.
Hostile control pod detected.
A great Hawaiian who loves Canada.
Another agent is now
tenth
in
island,
your group.
10th Island. I think that was Vegas, so it's 9th Island. So I guess Canada's 10th Island. In any event, he was there this week, of course, to promote his fight at UFC 240, I believe, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Opposite Frankie Edgar, and while he's there, he spoke to the media. I think Aaron Brock there, some other ones up there. And he basically made the argument, Danny, that, okay, so things didn't go great against Poirier, he was the better man than I gave all the credit in the world, but he says, you know what, I'm going to fix. Get close to at 155. Now, at the top of that division, you've got Habib at the top. I'm not saying it's the exact order, but something like this. Then you've got Poirier, then you've got Connor, Tony, you've got Cowboy, you've got Edson, you've got Ally Aquinta. Is Max Holloway in the mix with those guys?
I think so. I mean, he fought Poirier, you know, a super tough guy, you know, probably the second best lightweight there, right? I mean, you can make an argument for that. But he fought somebody that's super legit, and also he didn't get much time to acclimate to the division. So when he does get another chance, because as I said it a million times on this show, his days at 145 are numbered. You know, he can easily jump back in there and fight anybody, and if he does the process right, I think he can compete with most guys. I mean, he went...
Tell me who he beats at that, those names I mentioned. Edson Barboza, Iaquinta, Cerrone, Poirier.
For example, well, I don't want to single out fighters, but for example, I like his chances against Iaquinta.
Taking the capital will deal a huge blow to the True Sons.
Yeah.
But the priority is to get back the briefcase President Ellis is carrying aboard Air Force One. Kelso's waiting aboard a helicopter to extract it as soon as he's secured.
So, and not only that, but if you look at that division, all those guys, Tony Ferguson,
what
Ellis told
us is true. A lot of
people
in that case for him.
35.
You have civilian assistance to get you through the perimeter.
36.
But you'll be on your own once you're inside.
32. You name all the fighters in their 30s or mid-30s. Max Holloway's 27. Say he sticks another year or two at featherweight, at most, right? All those guys are not going to be in their prime anymore. So this conversation would be a lot different.
It's quite odometer.
I mean, he's also Hawaiian and when they did tough. I mean, when was the last time he got stopped?
I don't understand this comment. One of them is saying I think it's a clearer and quicker path to a title at 155. Hey, Max, 155 is historically deep, right? insanely deep right now, and it's still insanely muddled from the idea of people that are deserving Tony Ferguson to get right now. But here's what the news here. So here's my point. When I saw that Max Poirier fight, like I saw one of the fights here, I saw Max fight his heart out like he always does and never stop trying to win that fight. But if we're going to use that fight as a comparison of how Max would deal against these super elites, and by the way, lightweight, almost super elites, I think I saw a tolerant size gap that works against his style. That yes, he would be able to compete in that top 10 without working out last and stop in terms of, you know, exhaustion and accumulation. But I don't see him as a
to get in there and finish this.
Moving up and, like you said, restructuring his body, I think he has a style that against the very elites will lead to him accumulating a lot of damage.
Yeah, I think so too. My point being is this. I think I'll split the difference between the both of you. I think Danny's right that based on name value, the fact that he is, as we speak today, still a champion, you kind of have to take that seriously, so I do. However, the physical nature and the way in which he lost against Dustin also makes me think taking a bit of a step back, not a huge one,
yeah,
a little one. That's why I like the 6-7 spot, Quinta Barboza. That is where, like, let's fight those guys, or one of the two. You look good against them, hey, now we're cooking.
And that's all part of, you know, getting acclimated and doing a proper move to 155. You don't want to fight the top dog right away. You want to ease your way into that division. And obviously, you know, the top 10 is still a tough ask, but nonetheless, it's not fighting the number two guys.
Radio.
It's
intercepted.
Those sort of guys can believe the
sir, proximity charges just detonated in the rotunda.
One thing, though, I didn't like the spirit of Max's comments. That's largely what I'm referring to. But when I say that is, I don't think
it's the RFID code we're looking for. The briefcase must be close. Copy that, Kelso?
Loud and clear. Stand by.
I wasn't ready and all that stuff. I get it. I didn't think it made any sense for him to throw in the comments now. But I'm still in that mix. I still want another title shot. It's like, you kind of just got humbled. Go back to 45 and own that kingdom until you can't make that way.
Yeah, I got that.
Once you acquire the briefcase, head to the roof of the rotunda and wait for the helicopter.
Come with us.
Understood. They'll need to be clear before the helo can approach.
I almost caught off guard on this one a little bit, which was, I haven't noticed something.
Assistance.
Machida at MSG, we didn't know who was coming out of that Rory John Fitch fight. And if you're Bellator, there's no chance under any circumstance you're putting John Fitch and Neiman Gracie in the main event of a 10-full card like this. So I think announcing the Chael, who brings in the fans,
we're
obviously,
on station,
that fight,
small arm
and
range.
Then you have the
good
situation where Rory
advances,
you go, okay, well, look, we're not going to do a 5-round co-main event title fight when we have Rory, who is the biggest pickup in our promotion's history in terms of getting a guy in his prime. So I think doing the last-minute switcheroo might not look the best, but who cares in the end? It really doesn't matter who's going to go on last, but I think it would be smart, if I had a choice, to put the title fight on last because it means so much for that tournament, it means so much for a title defense, and then you have the added thing of, is Rory ever going to be nice enough? I think that's something to drive that would make sense for. I don't think debating it.
Also, I don't think it was only a question of, oh, we don't know who's going to come out between, you know, Rory and McDonald. I mean, McDonald and Fitch. But also, those two fight cards were, what, 6-7 weeks apart? So, you don't want to start promoting, you know, your main event and championship out and have one of those guys come out injured, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, well, we're just going to bump this one. All of a sudden there's no more main event. So, I think they did the right choice in, you know, keeping Machida and Sonnen as the main event. And then as soon as, you know, that got figured out, you know, they bumped it. And at the end of the day, like, this is a title fight. They should, you know, they should honor the champions. And also, not only for honor, but, like, Bellator should start, and not start because I think they already do, but, you know, they should try to push them to value their titles a lot more. And I think when you put it in a co-main event, for you guys, you know, you're sending a message to the fans. What is more important? Either our name value or these guys that made their name in another promotion or actual world title. And I think that's what they're doing here. I think it was the right call.
Here's my view. I don't.
Hey, look, at the end of the day, the fight just doesn't happen here.
Exactly. So here's my view. I don't care what method they go through. I think the only weird one would be let's have Rory versus Neiman at the top. On it. Advertising dollars, why would you not promote Chael Sonnen? And also, if you're Chael Sonnen, well, you got your hands full with media obligations because Neiman and Rory ain't going to carry for you. I mean, Neiman, don't get me wrong. These are great people, but not everybody is great at doing media. It's just a reality of the business. Chael Sonnen is, so he's got a heavy load there. I'll be honest about this, though. Like, I've come around a little bit. I'm of the belief that, like, I have zero issue putting title fights and then working after fights below it. No problem. Fine. I will sleep. Just fine. On the other hand, if they did it the other way, I wouldn't really care either.
Yeah, but
you've got executives voting that position thing. The titles don't mean anything. It's just the trophy you give to the best fighter that night. Why am I supposed to dignify their title? Why is it my responsibility then to say, oh, no, you must treat this with me exactly the same as it is? No, you just said under oath that this is a trophy and it doesn't mean anything. Fine. Put it on the card where it deserves to be, which may or may not be at the top.
Yeah, I think in the end, I don't think it's a battle worth arguing. I thought it was refreshing to put Rory in the main event and give the title value, and I think it's a right move. But if you want to put the script and talk about UFC 238, I would rather UFC go, look, it's the biggest story on this card. We're making that the main event, and it's going to be 5 rounds. You know, the great title fight is now advertising for that. If they went in that direction, I kind of wish they would go in that direction.
You can talk champ all you want. That's not a fight that should be made. I think Oliver Reich is the most deserving fan to win contender of the third. If there is, going right down to that about it. But I'm sorry, I have nothing against him. But the TJ won, whatever. This is not the TJ. On top of it, you've got Tony Ferguson's biggest fighter in the card. You have to be fighting. Winning is the UFC fighter of all time.
Who is not the main event brand?
That's
no question
about
it. You know what I mean? It's like, are you kidding me? Why would that not be the main event? Oh, no disrespect to Valentin Shevchenko. Probably gonna. I don't know what's gonna happen, but it's past full up under one urgent guy. So where does that leave you? It leaves you in the space where, well, again, if they wanted to defend the titles, that's fine. But under deposition, not what y'all are telling us about the value of these things. So point that out here a little bit. Alright, so here's something that's kind of interesting about UFC's weird choices. Sort of Elias Theodore was finally made his return to social media. And I know it has to be hard for him, man. You lose your job like that. Went 8-3 in the promotion.
When the rules are clear, send up a player to signal
up. Win streak in his last four. Did lose his last one to Derek Brunson. Came off of the Tough Nations show back when he was like 25 or 26. And they cut him. They cut him coming off of a loss. I guess the rule is if you're coming off of a loss, they can legally do it, if and even if you have fights left in your car. Or, sorry, your contract. I don't know if he was at the end of it or not, but that reached out to him, and you're back. But in any case, they let him go, Danny. So let's sort of dig into this a little. We touched on it on Monday's show.
Yep.
But we've had some time to think about it. He got out there and was saying on social media, he goes, I thought it was my job to outsmart my opponents and present a difficult challenge for them, and that's what I did. And if that's how he sees his job, then he's right. The problem is, I don't think your employer sees your job that way.
That's true. I mean, if that wasn't true, he'd still have a job. And that's what it came down to. It came down to exciting. I know that the MMA always touched on him, you know, no longer being this young prospect, kind of just being, you know, not trying to throw a knock on Fedora, but being sort of a finished product, like he is who he is at this point. But at the end of the day, even if another fighter was in the same position, but he was exciting, I'm sure they would have, you know, he would have stuck around. There is a value to maybe not being the best, but within the top 10, top 15, those guys that are not on the list to come up, but just kind of linger in that space. I think there is a value to that because they serve as a measuring stick. They serve as a measuring stick for fighters that are dropping off or prospects that are coming up. So I think that's very important, and I think the UFC values that. But it came down to, look, his fights just weren't all that exciting, and at the end of the day, it's an entertainment sport, and that's what the UFC is trying to do.
Yeah, you nailed it. It's not personal. It's not really a sport. It's an entertainment product. It's a heartbreaking cut if you look at the fairness of things. But so is a heartbreaking cut in the corporate world with somebody getting promoted a little bit higher than their worth actually is, but they're still a contributor. So, you know, that salary, sorry, we're going to cut ties with you. And I'm not necessarily trying to make that argument that he's a veteran, he makes more.
Are you defending foolish corporate America?
And it's easier for UFC to say, well, we can get a younger, more excited player and pay him a lot less. Maybe that's
away from confirmation.
All right. When you're ready, set up a flare so we can get that briefcase somewhere safe.
Dana White to give out bonuses for a reason to try to create more exciting matches. Not fair, but it's not like you didn't know this coming in. And look, UFC in the past, if they don't even like you, they can cut you. I mean, it's just the way it is.
So it sounds like, okay, I don't like the UFC's decision. If they had asked me, should we cut him, I would have said no. Sounds like you're saying you would have said yes.
No, I'm saying I'm not surprised. I'm saying it's on brand. I'm saying it's kind of consistent with their ways, whether you hate their ways or not. They'll let somebody with sometimes four or five losses in a row, an exciting fighter, linger because they think a TV fight's not the level Theodore was. Where he's sort of filling in those middle secondary card matches, they'd rather have
the exciting. It's almost a central tension, right? Like,
that won't
be enough.
We need to bug out as soon as things are clear.
Copy that. Those anti-defenses have to go.
Must be guidance for the fans.
Seek them out by any means necessary so the healer can approach.
Great. Your chances of sticking around the UFC are much longer than somebody that's, you know, pretty good, pretty decent, and really boring.
Here's the reality about this. Like, the insulation from that, if you're boring, is if you're really good. Right?
Right.
Because people are like, oh, the UFC is the bit where the best fight the best. And that actually is a true statement.
Okay, I have eyes on you. You're coming up on those radar trailers.
Knock him the fuck out and let's get this shit done.
The UFC, where the best are fighting the best. And you're on the bit of the outside where I think we could say Theodore was a good fighter. I mean, 8-3 in the UFC, that's hard to do.
I mean, he was a ranked fighter.
Right? So you're not among the very, very best, but you're certainly a credible, talented fighter. Then the equation changes dramatically. Then it's a question of, okay, well, how exactly, how entertaining exactly, how expensive exactly, how old exactly, how native to a particular era we are coveting their fan base exactly. And then if you fail enough of those tests by UFC management standards, then the whole thing collapses. You brought up something that I think is really important here. Every time the UFC makes a decision, they kind of tell you who they are. They take the mask off and reveal it.
An agent needs assistance.
It's an entertainment company. It's an entertainment company that happens to house a lot of the very best fighters, and you want to get a lot of the very best fights. But at its core, what they do, bro, they do entertainment. And if that isn't enough to supply, in addition to the book Monday where, you know, he was 25 when he got into the company. Okay, you're not super exciting at 25. But at 31, it's still the kind of same thing, and you've fallen short on those other...
If you're not a company man, then if you're not a, you know, banger,
do you think that they were put off by the marijuana advocacy?
That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't know if they didn't like him. I don't know the behind the scenes thing there, but it wouldn't have been the first time that they've sort of.
I don't think so. They got Nate Diaz on the roster. Sean O'Malley's out there, you know, doing his thing. I mean,
he's not anti company.
No, but I'm saying from the marijuana standpoint, as far as like, you know, advocating for that. I don't think he took it was more towards the product, towards the direction, like a man thing, but I don't think it was a combative standpoint. I think, you know, I think a lot of fighters have voiced that as well.
Yeah. All right, we'll see what happens. I mean, it's a bit of a wake-up call, unfortunately. Can you imagine losing your job and then having, like, here's the last thing I'll say about this. I remember distinctly, correct me if I'm wrong, when Jake Shields got cut, I detected much more fan revolt. Even when John Finch got cut, I detected more fan revolt. I detected virtually no fan revolt.
There's a difference. Those guys were former title challengers, and they were actually within that mix.
But I'm saying Nelson Oranges, those guys weren't necessarily like all exciting, you know, selection.
But they had big names, strong brands, you know, Jake Shields, you know,
I'm not speaking about my personal brand, just say what the general perception was. I thought Jake Shields was going to cut out. I was gonna go into the Endeavor going pump, which we are gonna go into. I think we're gonna do your rough work for the radar. Let's go into a little bit early, and we'll just put that topic in there. Talk about where it's got a little less attention. So Endeavor has gone public. People have asked me, like, what it means. Not sure yet. I'm not sure if anybody knows what it means, to be quite honest with you. Like, how will it affect the UFC's business, and what does this mean for fighters? I don't know. I don't know what it means. But Brian had a bit of an interesting nugget that I thought was worth a little bit of extra discussion. Well, I want to build
that. In the boxing world, the Twitter sphere, the rumor central, the past couple of weeks, there's been a discussion going on. Things have seemed to leak out.
Confirming
here.
One trailer out of action.
Okay, knock out the other one.
Which is a promotion-ish in boxing that has access to more than half, let's say, of the best sport has TV contracts, of course, with Fox and Showtime. Maybe up for sale, and Endeavor may be looking to purchase it. Now, there is history. Late last year, I got a big time over where Endeavor did look into the idea of purchasing Top Rank, which is the boxing promotion bomb there that ESPN has a deal.
No.
What this would mean for MMA, anytime Dana White gets interviewed, the idea of boxing gets breached. He says, look, it's still coming. We still got big plans. And later this year, we're still going to have big news for you. And we all sort of roll our eyes and go, yeah, whatever. What about this? Information here, but these rumors are out there. The idea of what it could potentially look like if Endeavor got into boxing space, if they picked up a group of fighters as large as the PBC, and Dana was able to sort of exercise not his demons, but his long interest in boxing. And obviously, we know he built UFC off of the things that boxing wasn't doing, the longtime boxing fan. And if he became the czar of boxing, they acquired that many
names,
kind of recognizable, and essentially tried for the first time to bring a league to the boxing game. It was very interesting.
How expensive would PBC be?
It's fairly large, but it's nice.
A million?
No. It's nice. You'd essentially be buying it. It's not a structured league. You'd be buying the managerial share. It's interesting. It wouldn't be easy. Boxing's a cutthroat sport. You'd have promoters and networks rebelling against that. But no one's ever trying to do the insulated league. Trying to in some ways create their own title belts inside. In some ways trying to go against the boxing model and basically make the best fight the best. It always seems like an impossible journey. But as a boxing fan, a deep-down, hardened, cynical boxing fan, you hear that news. You hear, imagine if Dana White can bring those organizational styles into a boxing fan. It's interesting. That was
a perception. But not of this inevitability or lack thereof, but of Dana White's efforts to be involved in boxing, inside boxing.
I think he'd be welcome from the hardened fan. He wouldn't be welcome from the powers that be who are slicing each other's throats at all times to try to get, you know, whatever remaining slice of the pie. I don't think he's well respected for building up UFC to something that has boxing in certain terms, in terms of the institution. So I think it'd be very welcome. There'd be a lot of issues. It's not like we're close to this happening, but it would be interesting because it's never been a giant move going public. Although I think he's not Dana White's comment about if they did go public.
Said when the Fertitta brothers would leave, he might get
put. No, but on that point, though, because if you go public, the financials go public. And if you read that Endeavor statement on when they did go public, there were the risks written out there. One of the risks are the fighter.
see you. Sector clearly down.
Could the UFC exist as it does now if the financials were public?
Probably, but it would be certainly. I think they want to solve this other lawsuit that they have and bury the Ali Act in Congress as thoroughly as possible.
John Lineker is asking for a fighter his release. He did a recent interview with MMA Junkie and basically said he's working at a pet shop, which I can't picture, but sure.
He actually said this?
Yeah, he's working at a pet shop. And he has 5 kids and he doesn't really have money to, you know, sustain it. Because he's fought 4 times in 30 months. He's fought 3 times since 2017. And he just doesn't get booked. Now, to be fair, I went back and looked at his record. There is 3 canceled bouts within that span, and 2 of them came due to injury from his part. But nonetheless, you know, he heals up and he wants to fight. He says he's healthy now and he's not getting any fight. You know, the guy who he fought last just got a fight against, you know, Rafael dos Anjos. So he's pretty frustrated with the way the promotion is booking him. Apparently, it's not enough, and clearly, obviously,
no further contacts.
30 months
area
is
secure.
Not enough.
Copy
and the dude wants to make money, you know, he wants to make some money and feed his family, so he's either asking for a fight or his release. And
that's the opposite of John Fitch. And
yeah,
all those
it's
other
things. Weird because
he's
super exciting.
Not
only is he exciting, but he's actually a legit talent. You know, I wouldn't say maybe top 5, but you're definitely in the top 15. So
when you have that power, you're always the top 5.
Always. So I don't know why the UFC perhaps isn't booking him. Perhaps
we
not
have
many people want
to
take him on.
Taking fire. We're out of here.
Case is secure. Trusun's lost their stronghold. And General Ridgeway has been neutralized. Of all the toys on my map I've been waiting to knock over, that fucker was the one.
Just go out there and save him, good.
A lot of good people from my old unit are dead because of him.
Hazard, I guess, but
some even went over to his side. Set up a flare from the front steps to signal the all clear. You come on home. Let's celebrate.
I asked her, I was like, oh, you must be psyched to be off for summer. No, she does online teaching, which means no summer's off. In fact, she has to teach the donks who failed and are trying to keep up with their peers, so it's summer school. And poor Felicia Spencer has to teach these retreads and also prepare for Cyborgs for what is probably going to be not a ton of money. I'm excited for her because I actually think she's, like, crazy talented.
Yeah, she's really good grappler.
You know what I'm talking about, like, from unknown to now you're fighting Cyborg in the co-main event of a pay-per-view?
Ooh. Yeah, here's 2 plane tickets to hell.
Yeah.
Cyborg's sold away now, yeah.
That is a tough grind, so good luck to her. That should be an interesting fight. All right, well, that is it for us today. Enjoy UFC Stockholm if you can. We will, of course, have coverage of it. I believe Pete Sicaro.
Pete Sicaro's there. There's actually interviews up now from his work in the media day.
There you go. So you can follow him on Twitter. You can also
the briefcase is secure. Tucson's lost his stronghold.
And
General Ridgeway has been
neutralized.
Until
next time.
Of all the toys on my map, I've been waiting to knock over. That fucker was the one. A lot of good people from my old unit are dead because of him. Some even went over to his side. Set up a flare from the front steps to signal the all clear. And come on home. Let's celebrate.
An age is over. Your group. You have been promoted to group leader.
And now, it's time for the voice of mixed martial arts.
Pumping to the Great Wall of China and back to the streets of Stockholm, Sweden, where the UFC is coming. We are live. This is In Time Radio, the show we talk about. We will voice it for you. We talk about everything on its time. Politics, film, TV, UFC, sports, you name it, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and we talk about it because it's No Holds Barred Radio, folks. I'm here today with my co-host, TJ DeSantis. I'm off to Stockholm, Sweden tomorrow. I'm going to do a nice, good show here for you, talk about the week that was with my good friend, TJ. How are you, TJ?
I'm good, Buff. I'm fresh off a vacation to Walt Disney World. Pockets a little bit lighter, but the mood is elevated. I feel well-rested and had a good time with the family.
Yeah, it's expensive going to Disney World these days, isn't it? I know I gave away the many Disney World trips at the Make-A-Wish Foundation event a few weeks back, and very happy for those kids, and certainly say their family. Probably what does it cost you, like $1,000 or for a couple days of new there? What is the cost of going to Disney World these days?
It depends. I mean, everything is, an upgrade, right? So, like, the low package is not all that bad. Like, you can get by a family of four with a room and access to all the parks for about $150 a day, but that's not really the full experience. Let's just say my wife makes more money than me, so we got a lot of upgrades and packages, and cost about $5.
Not bad. How was the time? How did you enjoy it?
It was great. And $5,000 does sound like a lot of money, but when you think about it, you know, airfare, hotel, all of your meals, we had these, you know, character meals where we would sit in a restaurant and, you know, all the princesses of the castle would come by and take a photo, and then it would be all the animated characters like, you know, Goofy and Donald Duck and Mickey. And if you're going to do it, you got to do it right. We did it right. You know, I want to go back, but if we don't go back for another 5 to 10 years, at least we did it right the one time. And
I may be going back soon. I have not been there in 20 years. My boy Rupert is, you know, always asked me, you know, about Disneyland, so I'm probably going to have to go with him or want to go with him at one point.
Disneyland's a lot different than Disney World.
Yeah, I know. I know it is. I've not been to Disney World, but I am aware there's definitely a difference.
I mean, I love Disneyland. Don't get me wrong. It's a fantastic place, and for you and I, it's not that far from where we live. And everything that they did wrong with Disneyland, they just made better with Disney World. And obviously, there's double the amount of parks, and that's not even including like the water parks that they have down there. But it's truly a world. You're isolated from everything on the outside, and you can just be consumed with that Disney spirit.
Yeah, well, good. I mean, that's what life of the kids is all about. We're big kids at the same time, so I'm all for it. Memorial Day weekend, everything's good. Barbecue, got home in time.
Yeah. Actually, I got home in time to go to work. I had to work on the holiday. That's all right.
I work every day, just give or take something. It's always something to do, but I understand completely that choice. You know, it was a great day, great weekend, Memorial Day weekend, which is a weekend of honoring our soldiers who gave their lives for our freedom. It's something that's very important to me, as I'm sure is important to everybody that's listening, living here in our wonderful country.
Hey, shout out to your buddy, my buddy as well, Gary Randall. He posted a picture of his father, who was a Marine in Korea. Man, I see where Gary gets his looks from. He looks so much like his father. It's crazy. But
yeah,
very good to see that.
Very cool to see. I'm aware of that. I had the pleasure of knowing his dad before he passed. And heck of a guy. My dad also served in World War II in Korea, 13 years in the Marine Corps. You know, God bless them all, man. Everybody. I had friends here. I have a lot of friends that are Marines, a few key friends, and they're still, you know, up for going back over if they're called down to duty. And once a Marine, always a Marine. So, all my best wishes.
Yeah,
all the mentality.
We have so much great face of men and women that defend our country every day. I think that a lot of people feel uncomfortable in our, you know, sanitary lives for being caught up with, you know, stupid things like the Jersey Shore back in the day, or Kardashians, whatever it is that sort of, you know, keeps the entertainment wheel going around. You and I are also consumed with our own, you know, work lives and everything, but we forget about really what the world is like in certain areas, places that don't have the freedom and privilege.
And
that we have that freedom and privilege is what's better. We all do need to really stop and think about it a few times each year. Really thank those men and women who possibly make the whole sacrifice so you and I can continue to go about our lives the way that we're accustomed to.
Exactly, well said, and I hope everybody yesterday during your barbecues, during your eating your brats and everything else at the barbecue, your beer, the whole bit, your desserts, being with your loving families and friends, that you took at least a moment to reflect.
this freedom. So with that note being said and moving forward, we're on to a great week here. We've got a busy week. We got the UFC coming up in Stockholm, Sweden on Saturday. Last week we had the RK show of Elias Theodoro on the show, and right after we put the show up, as his name has happens on It's Time Radio, the next day or the next minute something occurs and Elias was released from the UFC. Kind of surprising, TJ, because didn't he win his last like 7 or 8 fights?
He lost his last fight, but yeah,
he's
got a very good record and he's a very talented fighter. Unfortunately, some people aren't the biggest fans of Elias Theodoro's style. It's kind of an awkward style, but it works for him, though, and that's kind of what I like. I like fighters that are a bit quirky, and Elias is quirky inside and outside of the octagon. Unfortunately, his career will move forward outside of the octagon, but I firmly believe that someone like Elias Theodoro, even though he got his walking papers, if he keeps winning and does it big on the outside of the UFC, I'm sure he'll be back. I'm sure he'll have the opportunity to be back. And if not, we live in a great world with technology, and if you're a big fan of Elias Theodoro, you'll probably be able to watch him continue his career and follow him wherever he goes. That is what's neat about modern mixed martial arts with technology. You don't necessarily have to be fighting at the biggest show. I'm sure he'll be just fine.
He'll be fine. He's going to be picked up in a heartbeat, if not picked up this week. I mean, it's going to happen real quick, in my opinion. Uriah Faber stepping out of retirement. He's coming back to fight in Sacramento. I don't think you're fine. It's a big surprise. Uriah Faber's in great shape. What's his life neglected? And he's a true fighter, so I'm not surprised by this. Happy to see it, as long as everything's healthy and good for Uriah. And I look forward to announcing him at UFC Sacramento, which, if I'm not mistaken, I think I am doing. When is that?
I don't even know. I'm focused like you are in Stockholm coming up this weekend, and I don't really look much more than Uriah
required. July 13th, yeah, I'm scheduled for that, so I'll be there in Sacramento to announce Uriah, who I love watching and announcing him, no question. All right, let's step back a couple weeks. Last week at the archive show, I wanted to talk about this with Sage Nordercutt over in the World Championship debut. 29 seconds into the fight, I'm sure you talked about this on the shows, but for the benefit of our listeners, I want to comment on it. First round knockout of the One Championship debut, it turns out he suffered 8 fractures. He's in surgery with 9 hours of damage. Yeah, he's got a great attitude. We're seeing him there. TJ, for the life of me,
friendly combatants nearby.
Everything he's been through, fighting, he's been hit in the face before. This is a punch. It almost made me feel like, and I'm not saying anything, but it's almost like the old boxing days when they found plaster Paris and the wraps. I think the punch is harder. It's like, wow, 1 punch, 8 fractures. I mean, this is not something we hear about common. And it was perfectly placed or whatever. I just hope Sage comes back strong. A lot of fractures in the handsome face of Sage Nordcutt.
When I heard about it, it was just a stark reminder that, you know, combat sports are inherently violent. The damage is real. And, be thankful that we see, you know, injuries like this very rarely. And the men and women that go out there and fight for our entertainment aren't, you know, going into surgery after fights like this all that often. You mentioned Sage's attitude. He was taking photos, putting it online, still smiling as much as ever. Even if his face was broken, you can't take that smile off that kid's face, which, you know, speaks volumes about him as a fighter and a human being. But yeah, that's what I took away from it, Bruce. I immediately just thought, wow, I get caught up a lot in, you know, breaking down fights and who's going to win, what's really up for grabs and at stake in each fight. We talk, you and I, every week about someone's legacy and whatnot moving forward, that we very rarely kind of sit back and talk about, you know, what someone like Sage Northcutt is putting on the line to fight and risking, and that is his well-being.
Wow.
Unfortunately
That's
for him,
awesome.
It didn't go the way he wanted to, result-wise and injury-wise. I can't imagine having your face literally broken. But while his face may be broken, I'm sure the heart of Sage Northcutt is far from broken.
Now, his spirit's strong. He's good. I mean, it seems all that way. You know, just hope he recovers 100%, goes on to do what he needs to do. To make his money and further his career.
Yeah.
I mean, working in One Championship, they've got a lot of money. They take care of their fighters from all I can see. They've openly been speaking about the fact that there are certain fighters they would not have in their roster. I think they mentioned Conor McGregor as one of them.
I don't believe it. Sorry.
Well,
you want to make money? You, you want to make money? No offense to one championship, but it's easy to say.
You heard that, right?
I didn't hear that necessarily, yeah. But it'd be easy for Bellator to say the same thing. You know, hey, look, we don't want Conor McGregor. We would never have him here. Well, first off, you can't.
Drinking water detected.
Second off, I don't know if you could afford him. Maybe you could. But if you could and he wasn't under contract, you would absolutely have him. Why? Because he's a billion-dollar brand.
He's proven it. I don't know about a billion-dollar brand.
Hey, didn't you see he made $1 billion on whiskey or whatever? It was a tongue-in-cheek remark.
Tongue-in-cheek, but for the edification to our listeners, I have to step in for a second.
Yes, he's not a billion-dollar brand.
Not a billion-dollar brand. All the success and praise to Conor for whatever he's achieved or what he has achieved in his life, but the billion-dollar statement on the whiskey, he's, by our guesstimate, when I did the math, came to it, again, I could be wrong, approximately based on a $10 per bottle, $9 bottle case, 200,000 cases, approximately 18 million sales for his brand of Proper 12, which is still amazing,
hey.
Considering it only came out last year. It's amazing.
Right.
The all industry of whiskey has surpassed $1 million in sales, and Conor being the showman and the embellisher that he can be at times, they didn't say that that happened recently is like the Arnold Schwarzenegger incident. He's down in South Africa. He's in
He's doing his Arnold Classic, and after you probably saw this on the news, I don't know if you saw the video. Did you see the video where he's talking and signing autographs, and suddenly the back of him, a young kid runs up, jumps in the air, and does a flying double leg kick, slamming both feet into Arnold's back, pushing him forward into the crowd. He wasn't hurt, he didn't fall down,
food supplies
but he very
detected.
Well could have been hurt. He's 72 years old. He very well could have had a number of things that happened to him. He was just falling down. I don't think the man was arrested, but as he did this, did you see this video, TJ?
I did, yeah.
And then you hear yelling, I want my Lamborghini! I want my Lamborghini! Because he thinks by doing that, obviously putting two and two together, unless I'm wrong, that's a move that's going to make him money. Listen, people, if you're listening out there and you think you've got to do selfies hanging off the end of a cliff or do stuff like that, which is completely asinine, not much counting the fact that you're to be arrested by assaulting something like that, don't be stupid. I just want to say that message. I saw that. God, I wish Arnold would have turned around, but it's a young kid. He can't hit him. But the bottom line is it was wrong.
Detecting
no
additional hostile contacts.
There's nothing right about that. It was wrong. They thought he was hurt.
72 years of age or not, you don't try to drop kick the Terminator. He'll be back.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. His bodyguard, security, eventually got a hold of the guy and cranked his neck.
Oh, they didn't give him a Lamborghini?
No, they gave him a Armatini.
Oh,
all I can tell you. Got it quick. All right, now what I want to get on here is when you're a celebrity or you sign an endorsement contract, like others that we know that represent products like myself. Okay, in that contract, there is a morals clause. And you can easily lose, as we've seen people lose those contracts left and right when they, when something happens. So you got to be careful. And I'll give you an example of a contract I signed recently that I'm very happy to announce. Relax Gaming, a very big group out of Europe and other areas, they make the online gaming machines that are being now put on sites, gaming sites, betting sites, that have gaming machines, online slot machines that are legal throughout the world. They're one of the biggest companies, if not the biggest, that makes the most highest quality machines. Now, these machines online have proven to make as much, if not more, than those machines you see on the floors of casinos. When you go to a casino anywhere in the world, such as Las Vegas.
Sure.
So now Michael and I made a deal. They have now announced the week before, that they are launching the Let's Get Ready to Rumble online slot machine in September, with Michael being the face and voice of the machine. And they are launching the It's Time online slot machine in October.
Hostile broadcast.
The face and voice of that machine, both animated and real. And it's really cool. I've been going over the creative details with them. I'm meeting them in Stockholm for a large meeting on Friday to show me all that's being done. Because this is almost like making a video game. There's a lot of work to be done.
Well, I think it is making a video game. It's just instead of points, it's real money. You know what I mean? Like that's the allure to these things, Bruce, especially when you can get that casino type of feel, on your handheld device or on a computer or, whatever way that they make these things accessible to you online. You do it in the comfort of your own home. It's a win-win situation.
Yeah, it's really cool. I mean, Michael and I are excited. So it's going to be very cool. I'm going to make sure that these are very fun to play and very exciting to play because I want this machine to be revamped and go on for a very, very long time. So we're both very excited about this. You see the picture in the item I sent you?
I did, yeah.
Isn't that cool?
That's awesome.
Yeah,
also,
cool.
Control point nearby.
Looking forward to that. Stepping away from business a little bit. This is really getting crazy, but, Mount Everest, when you look at the people that used to climb that, maybe two people go up, four people go up.
Right.
This year has been very dangerous for Mount Everest. Matter of fact, an American last week, died on the overcrowded mountains since March. What? The 11th person since
detecting
March.
Detecting additional hostile contacts.
It's the end of May.
Yeah, exactly. So, but if you look at the picture that's in these articles that are going out, they are lined up one behind other, trekking up, with their Sherpa guides or whatever. It requires a Sherpa guide to get up there. So they have a
civilian in distress.
800 people trying to climb from the Nepalese side. Is that crazy?
Yeah, that's bonkers.
They rent to, excuse me, this year, they issued a record number of permits to foreigners this year because each of them requires a Sherpa guide. So there are 800 people trying to climb Mount Everest right now. Not at the same time, but have applied for permits.
Before it's done this year, 800 permitted climbers will attempt to make the trek. And I'm sure there are probably a lot of serious trauma detected while they're out there doing it. I'm sure it's glorious. I'm sure it's something that can never be taken away from you. Heck, maybe you put it on a resume. I don't know. But I'm not at a point in my life where climbing up a gigantic mountain is worth losing my life for.
No, it's crazy. You know, and to give an example before I cut off the story, an avalanche in 2014 on Mount Everest killed at least 12 Sherpa guides. A series of avalanches in 2015.
So the experts that are there to help your, you know, not capable self get up the mountain, they're dying as well. Oh my God.
Yes.
Does not sound like a fun activity. It sounds like a death wish.
Well, the last year, 2015, because of the Nepal earthquake that was massive back then, that caused the deaths of 19 people on the mountain.
Yeah.
They're climbing on the Nepalese side, if I'm saying that correctly.
Sure. I
admire what they're doing. It's like I just put out a thing on Instagram that was 6 years ago, give or take, that I was the first one to ride the Rio Hotel zip line.
Yeah,
Rio
zip line. Yeah.
Yeah, bike in hand, card in hand. When they hired me for it, we were talking on the phone. I said, listen, guys, I don't mind standing there and just announcing it, but I have told you before on the show many times, whether it's surfing big waves, I'm fine, stuff like that, but I have a fear of heights. I know I do, because when I'm on a tall building like Empire State Building or a 30, 40-story building in Century City or something looking over, I feel weird. So now on this one,
Third story of a mall, I feel weird, but...
Yeah, I'm with you there too. So I'm on 500 feet, basically 490 feet above the ground, going 33 plus miles an hour. I told them when they hired me for the job, I said, look, instead of standing there, let me be the first one to ride it, as far as the
friendly combatants.
Okay, you clarified. Not the first one to ride it. My goodness.
No, because they had testers.
Of course, yes.
But the first person to ride it at the time that you legally declared it open.
Right.
I said, let me be that person, and I'll make the announcement as I'm riding the zip line. Well, I didn't know what I was to expect when I got there. And I got up on top, and they put me in that chair, and I got to tell you something.
Hostile control detected.
Mr. Wizard, what am I doing here?
Right.
You know, this is crazy. But then, you know, once the seatbelt's on, very thin seatbelt, and when that thing went, it was like doing the 360 at UFC 100. If I didn't do what I said I was going to do, I was going to be the bitch in the internet.
Oh, man.
Or whatever. So I did it. I had a great time, but I will tell you that it was scary. I'll say it.
Yeah.
I'll just say it. Yeah.
Of course. But
I was fine after. I was fine after.
You get lost in your work, too. So,
yeah.
I saw you do a lip sync battle after you blew your ACL. So there you go.
Thank you for the memory. Appreciate that. Thank you for that one.
Friendly combatants detected.
That's okay. That's all right. No problem. As a matter of fact, somebody tweeted me on Twitter. They were the ACL organization of the world or something like that, and they wanted to know if, you know, was it true that when I blew my ACL, you know, did I not fall and stand up? And I told them, you know, yeah, I did it at UFC. What was it?
200.
No, it was the
162.
It was up there. It was up there.
St. Pierre Shields, whatever that one is.
George St. Pierre Shields, 55,000 people, largest UFC in the history of the UFC ever. Sold out in 17 hours. Now I gotta put my ACL. That got it. It's all good. All right, and it waited to happen until the very last announcement. Let's say George St. Pierre's name.
Oh, you would have still got in there and done it.
No, no problem. I had back in.
WWE, but there's a strong affiliation.
Control point secure. Well done.
State in the brain.
Good for them. I wasn't aware of that, number one. Number two, I remember when they were bought out by Authentic Brands Group, where Jamie Salter, the CEO of that, bought out Tap Out, so he probably negotiated that deal for them, whether he's involved or not. But get this. This is the reason I bring this up. Jamie Salter and the Authentic Brands Group now have bought the Sports Illustrated brand for $110 million.
Well, hopefully they don't ruin it like they did the Tap Out.
That was something I was going to stop on next in so many words. And let's just see what happens there. But did they ruin the Tap Out brand now that the WWE brand?
Oh, it was ruined before it was even off of MMA, to be honest with you.
Yeah, exactly. But I'm sure they're still doing well with the WWE. Listen, when Michael and I were involved with Michael, when I had a contract for him, and I was, I still manage him, but when I was managing the deal with WCW back in the 90s, part of our deal was the merchandising. And whenever we would do a deal with Let's Get Ready to Rumble or Michael's Image, TJ, they sold so much friggin' merchandise. I remember one time I put Let's Get Ready to Rumble on WCW action ring, right, which was a ring that vibrated and made noises, and it had all the action figures in it, including Michael Buffer's action figure. They had him on the cover. TJ, we had a minute percentage of this, right, considering how licensing goes.
Yeah.
But dang, they sold like $98 million in sales.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That was the wrestling boom period as well. And wrestling
not time.
Anywhere near that anymore. But I don't know. I read an article the other day that said Michael makes $500 million every time he steps in the ring. Make like $400 million every time he steps in the octagon. So I don't know what you're talking about. Licensing, marketing, you have more money than ever. You're probably richer than day one.
By standards of what they talk about. Correct, but now he's realized that I need to call Michael later today and ask where my cross commissions are. Wow.
Yeah.
Incoming hostiles detected.
It's all out there on the internet, bud.
Yeah, if that was true.
Yeah.
That he makes $1 million every time he says, let's get ready to run. He'd be on the cover of Forbes every year.
But no, $500,000. That's not crazy.
He'd be on the cover of Forbes at Time Magazine once a year. Yeah.
Buff, someone said to me not long ago and estimated them myself at $4 million. And I'd like to know where I can go get that money. I'd like to cash out. But,
let me step away from the story I was just about to go into.
Were you
going to
count some money?
Don't explain why that is dangerous, okay? Why this? That the new kidnapping that's rattling families across the U.S. now is what they call virtual kidnapping.
Right, yeah.
Trying to get money out of it.
Right.
Phoenix, this is where that can be harmful. Phoenix used to be, I don't know if it still is,
friendly
years ago, was declared
detected.
The kidnapping capital of the United States. Because what they would do, they found, they would find out how much money you had in the bank or what you, and they would actually, kidnap, God forbid, a member of your family and demand, whether you had $90,000 or $100,000 bank, demand that money, which means that they're getting that information from the inside, from people that know those details.
Right.
Horrible. So that's a bad thing. You think about virtual kidnappings. This is weird. Like, you get a phone call.
Right.
I have your son, and I'm going to F him up, the voice of the thing says. So for 2 hours in early April, the 61-year-old person named Joseph Baker's wife, Maggie, drove around their city listening to every demand of their son, Jake's supposed kidnapper, because they said, if you call the police, I will know, and I will kill him. I have a scanner. So they go around trying to do everything they can. They comply with his orders. They purchase prepaid debit bank cards, giving him the numbers, the kidnapper, filming themselves, flushing the evidence down the toilet. And when he hung up, he called the police. After they went through all this, who rushed to Jake's house, his son's house, along with a team of medics, and they found him home unharmed. It was all a scam. It was all a scam. This is a new scam going around.
I mean, it's really not all that new. Something like this happened probably a decade ago to my wife. Someone called her saying they had a member of the family in Mexico or something. She freaked out, called my wife's parents. They call somebody, and I don't know, it's bonkers. The one that I get every week, it was really bad 2 weeks ago. I get Apple tech support calling me, supposedly telling me that someone has hacked my iCloud account, and I need to have them reset some sort of technical support, whatever.
Supply
Target right. Near you.
Cool. How's this one for you? Half hour before the
control
show, I got
nearby.
A call on my cell phone. Hi, this is the Social Security Administration. You are about to be arrested.
No, it's not.
Yeah, of course not. Of course not. And we're just calling to let you know that you need to get back and call us because you're about to be arrested. Call us before you're arrested. The
friendly
police are notified that you will be arrested. They said arrested like 8 times.
Arrested.
I like hear the law and order like dun-dun gavel in the background when I picture it. Exactly. And of course, when I call back the number, it doesn't answer.
No.
Yeah, but they didn't make any financial demands. That's the weird part.
That's because they want you to answer the phone.
And also, you don't know, too, if it's one of those services out there that people use when they make those prank calls.
Right.
You know, so you don't know. Bottom line, folks, somebody calls you and says you're going to be arrested. You have money, and you're going on these sites and that site.
Agent,
it's
deceased.
All a scam, folks. Don't buy through the phone. Don't talk through the phone.
No.
You're talking to a man that ran telemarketing companies in my 20s. And yeah, I did things right. But I learned when I was in the industry that it is full of scams.
Oh, yeah.
Do once every day.
Yeah, and the big thing, too, is it just blows me away that anybody thinks that someone from a reputable company like Apple or the IRS or the Social Security Administration want payment via gift cards.
Hostage situation.
Gift cards.
Nearby.
Come on, people. Let's
gift cards and Bitcoin. And now that Bitcoin's going up a little bit again, there's going to be more Bitcoin scams, too. All right, Mackenzie Bezos. She's divorcing, her husband Bezos, Amazon.
Friendly combatants.
Jeff Bezos. She has now been said because she's going to inherit roughly $36 billion. She will be the world's fourth wealthiest woman. This is interesting, though. Okay, granted, $36 billion. How many billions do you need to?
Food supplies detected.
She announced on Tuesday morning she was signing the giving pledge. She's vowing to donate at least $17 billion away at which she gets her money. So she wasted no time deciding what to do with her fortune. That's for sure. She only got divorced officially less than 2 months ago. But you know what? $17 billion, put it out. And yeah, sure, she still has $17 billion left. You know what, people? Don't say anything negative about this. Hopefully she's giving it to solid organizations. She's giving away half her fortune, so that's enough right there.
She doesn't have to give away anything.
Doesn't give away anything. No, she doesn't. Another shark attack, TJ, and now he knows. Another shark attack.
Mr. Wonderful.
Detected.
No. A shark attack killed a 65-year-old man who's swimming off the coast of Maui. This is Maui. Maui has a shark attack. Granted, they're still rare. They make the news every time they have it.
Detecting additional hostile contacts.
The state this year. Third shark attack this year.
That's
a lot.
We hear about this all the time. It's still a very rare thing to have happen, period. But doesn't seem that rare.
No, not at all. Not at all. Are you taking sleeping pills?
Right now? No, I'm wide awake.
There's a big article, and you can go to CNN right now. Thank you very much. Got it. I was slow on that one. I vary like once a year. I carry Redestiv if I need it. I don't like sleeping pills. I'd rather take CBDs to go to sleep, which is really what I rely on now.
Getting on a plane, depending on where you're going, I wouldn't know if CBD is legal everywhere. No one's really going to get on you if you have an ambience.
Such a horrible analogy that was proper to make and horrible to realize that the drugs that are bad for you versus what's good for you. This is why I hope this all changes, why I'm so big on CBDs. I'm not going to go off on CBDs right now because we do it enough. But Lunesta, Sonata, Ambien, Ambien CR, Edular, Intermezzo, and Soft Mist.
What language are you speaking right now?
I'm speaking pharmaceutical language. They are going, I might not be doing it correctly. Several reports are rare, but serious injuries and deaths are coming, resulting. And I've heard of all these. I've heard all these stories.
Yeah.
Sleepwalking, sleep driving, other complex behaviors, such as just unsafe use of a stove that can cause even worse things to happen.
Right.
They're going to start putting those warnings on the box like they do on cigarettes. And also, as you see in the TV commercials, do you remember those TV commercials where they talk about a drug and the disclaimer and the premonition at the end of the commercial is longer than the actual commercial
right.
drug?
Or how about like this? Take this medication. It's designed to treat depression and suicidal thoughts. Side effects are depression and suicidal thoughts. Wait, what?
Yeah. Let me give you a couple other things here. From sleeping pills,
Okay. The FDA identified six reports of patients, accidental overdoses, falls, burns, near drowning, extreme temperature exposures leading to loss of limbs, self-inflicting gunshot wounds, suicide attempts. Were among the 46 non-fatal injuries. 20 deaths occurred due to carbon monoxide poisoning, drowning, falls, hypothermia, car crashes, and suicide. Okay, take your sleeping pills, folks.
Well, hey.
There are ways to learn how to sleep without taking drugs.
And one thing that you didn't mention in any of those incidents, because it's not a physical sort of disaster from taking these medications, but I've heard about this from several friends that I have that have taken these types
nearby.
Of medications. They essentially
hostile
go on shopping spree on Amazon while they're under the spell of this medication and wake up and go, oh my God, can I please cancel
target
the
is near
$500
you, agent.
Worth of clothespins that I just purchased?
Friendly combatants
I've heard
nearby.
About that too, TJ. Yeah, it's crazy. Listen, the bottom line is, folks, whenever you put anything in your body that is not your body's natural use, and we're talking drugs.
Right.
Okay, then, aside from the one to get high, depending on the drug you're choosing, or the one to solve an issue, depending on the drug your doctor is administering or prescribing to you, drugs are just, I mean, I try to avoid them at all costs. If you have to, you have to. But when it comes to painkillers and sleeping pills,
location guarded by heavily armed hostiles.
And my big thing about sleepwalking is I do it without drugs. It's all natural for me, Buff. Especially if I am in a place that I'm not accustomed to. And beyond that, if I'm
serious
to sleep to
detected.
Begin with, I will wake up in the middle of the night, walk around. It happens probably at least twice a year where I'll be on the road, like working for Invicta or something, and I wake up after I run my face into the wall in the hotel room because I don't know where I am, and I'm frantic.
That's crazy. That is crazy.
Yes. Yeah. Crazy. Medically. So.
Yep. Yeah, crazy medically. Crazy medically. Okay. A couple other stories here. One more to go to. Kind of a shocker when I look at it. Malaysia. Okay. Which is a country that receives plastic waste from other countries. Malaysia will send as much as 3,000 tons of public waste back to the countries it came from. The environmental minister said on Tuesday that they are the latest Asian country to reject rich countries' rubbish. Last year, they became the world's main destination of plastic waste because China banned plastic imports. I did not know that. It's interesting. Disrupting the flow of more than 7 million tons of trash a year. So dozens of recycling factories have cropped up in Malaysia, many operating without operating licenses. There's environmental issues going on in Malaysia right now, so I guess there's a lot more involved here. But last week, the government ordered to hire a private shipping company to send back 69 containers of garbage back to Canada and leave them within its territorial waters because they refused to accept them. Now, I've heard stories where some of the places where the trash is sent to, they just dump it in the ocean, and there's this huge float of plastic out there.
You can't dump things into the ocean in a certain territory and be okay with that, because the ocean, while it's not a river, still has current, and that current all goes away, and I don't know. I guess I'm kind of confused on... Why plastic is an issue? I thought plastic was recyclable. Why is anybody taking plastic and shipping it anywhere other than a recycling center?
Stop. This article says, right, plastic unsuitable for recycling is burnt. So obviously not all plastic is recyclable.
Why isn't burnt then? Why do you gotta ship it somewhere else to burn it?
Well, here's what happens. When they burn it, it releases toxic chemicals in the atmosphere, so then we're screwing up the atmosphere. Or an
but it's already being burnt. What's the difference if it's burned here or there or anywhere?
I cannot answer that. And then if it ends in a landfill, it contaminates the soil and the water sources surrounding the landfill.
So let's stop making plastic.
Exactly. Exactly. So what is the result? Glass? I mean, what is
I don't know. We live before plastic. We can live after it.
I'm with you. So now...
Unless it pays your bill.
The whole well, Malaysian officials have identified at least 14 countries of origin, including the United States, Japan, France, Canada, Australia, Britain.
Hostile control point identified.
Unwanted waste. It's just a major problem. I often wonder where all this waste goes. It's just that we see these pictures of the ocean. It's just
I was in Disney World this last week, and on property there, they did not allow anyone with plastic straws. No straws.
Well, there are straws, but they're paper straws, yeah.
And I hate paper straws.
Yeah, they tear.
Well, not even they tear, they steal money. It's crazy.
You told us that the other show, you made a special straw, right?
No, I don't know what you're talking about.
I think it's something else. You bought something. Go ahead.
You're talking to John Jones about straw? I don't.
Man.
No, I drank out of a glass like a normal human being would. I brought it up to my mouth, put my lips on it, and drank.
There you go.
How crazy is that? How barbaric is that?
Totally barbaric.
You know how much waste was made from that? None. Zero.
It's a re-education process of the human mind. We'll see. But something's going to come as a result of this, and it's going to be probably in a horrific state.
Target down.
As we're reading
good job.
About right here. All right, a last note on a good note. Aladdin came out. My brother Michael went to the premiere last week. He said it's awesome. He was telling me to take my little mom and see it. Obviously, a lot of people think it's awesome. The live-action reboot of The Last of Us was in 1992. It took in an estimated $112 million at the box office, just here in North America. That's awesome. Very, very cool. The projected return was $75 to $85 million, and this makes it the fifth highest-grossing film ever released on Memorial Day weekend. Very cool.
That's huge. I saw a preview for it. It looks fantastic. It is on the to-do list as far as movies.
Well, my to-do list is John Wick Chapter 3. I'm a big fan of John Wick. And Keanu Reeves' performance in John Wick, the guy really brings it all to his black, Tom Cruise, more so than this guy just trained like hell for a crazy for this show. I feel like
friendly combatants detected.
This movie that he made, and now 3. I actually watched John Wick 1 and 2 with Henry, my 14-year-old godson, just in the last 2 weeks. Got the okay from mom, and Rupert watched John Wick 2 with us the other night, and just reminding how exciting fun these movies are, because the bad guys are so bad, you can't wait to see them get there just to. Kind of like the Taken movies. So I'm excited about that. There's some good films coming out. Hi, TJ. I have got to get ready. I've got to get over to Stockholm. I got a number of videos for tonight to do before I leave. Again, people, thank you for sending them in. Really appreciate it. Having a great time. Getting a lot of podcast introductions lately. A lot of business requests for social media videos and audios to promote what you're doing on social media. And again, just send your requests in detail through to BruceBuffer.com. Just send it right through BruceBuffer.com. And there's an order form there for the special $99 championship personalized introduction that I do a ton of each week, which is an audio keepsake or video keepsake if you choose to.
Target spotted, Sheriff.
UFC fan and want to be introduced like a championship fight, fighting in the cage, and I'm there for you for all your requests within reason, and I do turn the number down because they're just not right to do. So, again, some requests
that that's your target.
TJ, I had a request last week, and I won't say any names, but they actually asked me if I would announce a certain country and its battle against a terrorist organization.
Huh.
I don't think I want to do that announcement.
No.
So not a good thing. No. But when you wonder the weird choice, the weird out of the box thinking requests,
sure.
I get, that was definitely one of my things. That's just
hey,
right there.
I mean, I you know what? I'm not going to say anything.
Politics. I don't get involved in politics. I have my own personal opinions, but I don't get involved in those kind of things. Not smart. No said. Hi, TJ. What's up to you this week? You're heading out, aren't you?
Next week.
Identify.
We'll have FC.
Target neutralized. Good work.
Watch live and free if you have a UFC Fight Pass subscription. Speaking of Fight Pass, last Sunday, 2 days ago, we record Combat Jiu-Jitsu World down. Check that out. Bantamweight tournament. It was exciting. It was thrilling. So watch it.
Sounds good. And what I want to touch on is this weekend, the UFC Fight Night in Stockholm, Sweden, is on ESPN2 for the prelims, and it's on regular ESPN for the regular show. That's great. I don't know what time it's going to come on. Check your local listings. But you've got Anthony Smith stepping back into the octagon shortly after his fight with John Jones, taking on the Swedish Viking, Alexander Gustafsson.
Good fight.
Good fight. I think this is actually a better fight for Anthony than John was. So then you have your Latifi taking
looks like
on
you earned
Hogan,
yourself another
Ozdemir,
bounty.
Ozdemir.
Well done.
Number 9, number 7, light heavyweight. It's going to be very exciting. Jimmy Manawa, always exciting to watch. number 11 light heavyweight contender taking on Alexander Rakic. And there's other good shows. Let me see here. Oh, Demir Hostick. I like watching him fight. And Tanya Heviger is on the show. Lena Landsberg. That's going to be good. Solid show. Always, you know, the UFC's really been putting out some very solid shows. I'm excited to go to Stockholm. Beautiful country. Beautiful country. Going to be great. And then I spent the following week in Chicago, if I'm not mistaken. So, on the road again. Had 2 weeks off. Now on the road again. And it's all good. All right, TJ, I am going to say goodbye to everybody. Give TJ your... give him your Instagram, your Twitter real quick.
At TJ DeSantis everywhere. If you're a podcaster and you would like some highly produced, highly stylized and professional podcast imaging, find me on Fiverr. I'm over there. Fiverr.com. F-I-V-E. And then 2 R's for some reason. But also on Patreon for all my mixed martial arts related podcasts. Patreon.com/betweenrounds.
Very cool. And for me, it's Bruce Buffer UFC on Instagram and at Bruce Buffer on Twitter. Facebook, just go to BruceBuffer.com. You can go to all my sites through BruceBuffer.com and, of course, find out about how to get your special voiceovers and audios and videos for your special occasions. All right, everybody, treat everybody with respect. Treat people the way you want to be treated. Be your role model, be your sphere of influence. Set your goals, write them down, learn about them before you set on that path. And when you do sit on that path of your life, just be the best you can be and do the best job you can do. And that means you're winning. And if the results aren't even winning more, well, that means you're just winning more. Just be the best you can be honest, be strong, and be respectful. Buffer out. Talk next week.
The preceding podcast was a TJ DeSantis production. Comments, questions, and inquiries can be directed to DeSantisProd@gmail.com.
Hey, Joe Rogan podcast by night, all day.
Why should you say that?
Why that?
I'll tell you, when I first moved to Los Angeles, I was playing this basketball league with these kids from East LA. It was like the only connection I had in LA with these like couple of kids that I knew from Long Beach.
Okay. Let's see what we're getting today. Surgical.
Hey, Agent. We got a project that's ready to be completed. Whenever you have the time.
agent in need of backup.
Thank you.
Okay, let's open these bad boys up. What? That's a nice one. stolen, which be stolen. Thank you.
test.